This evening we'll be having a question answer session. I already have questions here with me, which I'll try to answer. Here is a question. What is the difference between chapter 3 and chapter 5? Here the sense is the titles, specifically the titles, or the title indicating the contents. Chapter 3, the title is Karma Yoga. And chapter 5, the title is Karma Yoga, Action in Krishna Consciousness. So both are actually describing Karma Yoga, both the chapters. Still there is a difference. If I may put a suffix for chapter 3, Karma Yoga, performing prescribed duties in Krishna consciousness. So the difference is that chapter 3 is Karma Yoga, performing duties in Krishna consciousness. Chapter 5 is Karma Yoga, action in Krishna consciousness. So the difference is between prescribed duties mentioned in chapter 3 and action, simply action or activity mentioned in chapter 5. So in chapter 3, Lord Krishna describes, in response to Arjuna's question, Arjuna's question in chapter 3 is, why do you want to engage me in this ghastly warfare if you think that intelligence is better than performing fruitive work? So in response to that question, Krishna elaborately explains Karma Yoga, performing prescribed duties in Krishna consciousness. So Krishna says in third chapter that one cannot be inactive at any time, any moment. One should always be active, doing something. So therefore Krishna recommends that if you don't perform activities according to the Vedic directions, prescribed duties, then you'll be engaged in some other activity which will cause bondage for you, which will cause which will give you reactions. Therefore Krishna says, perform prescribed duties. But how should it be done? Prescribed duties, how should it be done? It should be performed in Krishna consciousness. Means every activity, every duty that is to be done should be done as sacrifice to Vishnu. Whereas in fifth chapter, action in Krishna consciousness means it is a little advanced stage for a person who's already understood that my only business is devotional work. Karma Yoga in the fifth chapter particularly refers to devotional work. Karma means work, and yoga means to link up with the Supreme. And the Supreme is Lord Krishna. Therefore, Karma Yoga in the fifth chapter means to perform all activities in Krishna consciousness. So therefore, the fifth chapter is not only prescribed duties, but any activity. Any activity, all activities. So that's a more advanced stage. That is explained in the fifth chapter. Next question. Kindly explain what is meant by painter, painting and easel in Bhagavad Gita 13th chapter 3rd verse purport. What each corresponds to? Bhagavad Gita, please. So in the 13th chapter, in the third verse, Srila Prabhupada is explaining in the purport that one should not confuse the three specific entities mentioned in the first three verses of the 13th chapter. The field of activity, which is the body, and the individual soul, who is a knower of the field, one of the knowers, and the super knower, the supreme knower, the supreme lord in the heart of everyone, is a super knower, is a knower of the field or the body in everybody. So distinctly, these are the three entities mentioned in the first three verses. The body, the individual soul, and the super soul. So one should not confuse the three, clearly understanding the difference. So Srila Prabhupada gives an example. Just like there's a painter. Now when he is painting on a canvas, then to hold that canvas for him to properly paint, there's something called an easel. Easel means a stand. So one should not confuse the three. The painter, the painting means the canvas, and the easel, the stand. Now each have got their own specific position. Now, just like the super soul is actually the actual controller of both the individual soul and the body. Though it appears like the individual soul also is able to control his body. But in reality, that limited amount of control that an individual's person or a soul exercises over his or her body is actually permitted by the Supreme Lord as Paramatma, as the super soul. So now the painter is the one who is actually the controller of the canvas, what is going to be painted on the canvas, and the easel itself as a stand for holding the canvas for him to paint. It is never that the painter has no ultimate control over the painting and easel. The painting and easel have got their very limited or a small part to play in the entire activity of painting by the painter. But ultimately, it is, then the next question, where in 6th chapter traditional Jnana Yoga is explained? In the 6th chapter, traditional Jnana Yoga is not explained. What is explained is traditional Ashtanga Yoga in the 6th chapter. Next question, what's the difference between traditional Karma Yoga and our Karma Yoga? Traditional Karma Yoga means to sacrifice the results of one's activities to the Supreme. To offer the results of one's activities, either entirely or even a portion of it, to the Supreme. That is traditional Karma Yoga. Whereas Karma Yoga, as explained by Krishna, is actually devotional service, where one sacrifices the results of one's work to Krishna. So that is the difference. Of course, Srila Prabhupada explains, even if one does not know the supreme cause is Krishna, if he sacrifices the result of his work to the supreme cause, to the ultimate cause, then gradually he will be elevated to Krishna consciousness. The next question, how to identify that we are not this body but the spirit soul? We know that body and soul is different, but how can we practically identify that we are spirit souls? Now, knowledge is one thing. You read the Bhagavad Gita, you hear from a proper authoritative source, and you try to understand that I am not the body, I am spirit soul. But to practically identify, Krishna explains this in the second chapter itself, in the 13th verse. Krishna says, just like within this body, I am going through changes of the body. Boyhood to youth to old age. I am experiencing the changes, but I am the same person. Similarly, Krishna says, of course, at the time of death, we change this body and we give up this body and we enter another body. Now, this example that this illustration or analogy that Krishna has given, just like in this body, we are changing the body. Boyhood to youth to old age, childhood to youth to old age. So we can understand that my body has changed. Body is not the same, but I am the same person. So definitely if the body has changed and I can clearly identify I am the same person, that means I am different from the body. This is one way of understanding that practically we are not the body, we are spirit soul. Next question. One engaged in devotional service attains Brahman. That is what Bhagavad Gita 14th chapter 26th verse mentions. Is it the same as attaining Brahma Jyoti? Now let me try to briefly tell what is Brahman and what is Brahma Jyoti. Now the word Brahman is used to explain the spiritual platform or the spiritual realm. And when we say Brahma Jyoti, it refers to the spiritual sky which is full of effulgence. That effulgence originally is emanating from Krishna's transcendental form. So Krishna is the source of that Brahma Jyoti or Brahman effulgence or the spiritual light in the spiritual sky. So yes, the Brahman, what is described as impersonal Brahman in the spiritual sky, that is same as the Brahma Jyoti. But here, when it said one engaged in devotional service attains the Brahman, Brahma Bhuyaya Kalpate, that is a Sanskrit, attains Brahman means comes to the Brahman platform, spiritual platform, above the three gunas, above the three modes of material nature. One is able to transcend the three modes, one is able to rise above the three modes, one is able to become completely immune to the influence of the three modes by simply engaging in devotional service. Nothing else is required. So devotional service elevates one's consciousness to the spiritual platform. That's what is meant there. In next question, in the purport, Srila Prabhupada mentions first chapter 15th verse, that purport Srila Prabhupada mentions that the impersonalists cannot account for the senses of the living entities and are always anxious to describe all living entities as senseless or impersonal. How should we understand this? Do impersonalists or Mayavadis not believe or follow Bhagavad Gita? So when Srila Prabhupada says the impersonalist cannot account for the senses of the living entities, it means that the impersonalists, they have one theory, not based on scriptures, but they have a theory or a philosophy that says ultimately the absolute truth is impersonal. Impersonal means the absolute truth doesn't have any personal features, no senses, no form, no feelings, no qualities, etc., etc. But that is a completely wrong understanding, because the scriptures clearly describe that the absolute truth ultimate reality, God, is both impersonal and personal. Impersonal in the sense that in the impersonal feature of God, He doesn't have any material form, doesn't have any material qualities, doesn't have any material attributes, doesn't have any material, none of the material attributes. But God or Absolute Truth has spiritual form, which is completely transcendental, which is unlimited, which is a reservoir of all beauty, all wealth, all strength, all the transcendental qualities. So, since the impersonalists are unable to realize that, unable to understand that, unable to decipher that from studying the scriptures, so therefore they always want to describe both the living beings as well as the Lord or the Supreme Absolute Truth as senseless, without any senses, without any qualities, without any material. Actually, it is material, without any material senses. These senses that we have, material senses, these are actually not us, each one of us. We are different from the body, material body. So we have our spiritual senses, but they are covered by these material senses. So that the Mayavadis or the impersonalists cannot understand. Now, if the question is raised, do they believe or follow the Bhagavad Gita or not? Now, yes, they read the Bhagavad Gita. They have got their own commentary on the Bhagavad Gita based on the impersonal theory that ultimately the Absolute Truth is impersonal. And all living beings are non-different from the Absolute Truth in all respects. This is their theory. So based on this theory, they go on explaining or interpreting the verses of the Bhagavad Gita. They have their own explanation. Next question. Krishna says that he spoke Gita to the sun god millions of years ago. What was the specific incarnation of Krishna at that time? Now, this fact is mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna tells Arjuna that I spoke this Bhagavad Gita, the science of yoga, millions of years ago to the sun god. So, when Krishna is telling that, it means that Krishna incarnates in this world again and again and again, many, many times. Now, Krishna remembers all his incarnations because he has got unlimited knowledge, he's got unlimited memory, he's got unlimited all the attributes. He is unlimited Lord, unlimited personality. Whereas Arjuna is not unlimited person, is limited person. So Arjuna was always present with Krishna whenever Krishna incarnated in the past. But Arjuna cannot remember all his past births. Krishna can remember. So the specific incarnation of Krishna is not mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita. I don't know of any other source where this may be mentioned. But Bhagavad Gita and all the scriptures say that Krishna incarnates again and again. The next question. How can we understand and apply relevance of Bhagavad Gita in the current difficult situation of COVID? Bhagavad Gita specifically talks about how to attain the supreme spiritual peace. One of the specific characteristics of life in this world is that it is always filled with some disturbance of mind, some anxiety. In the Bhagavatam it is said, Sada samudvigna dhyam asadgrahat. Anybody who accepts a material body and consequently becomes active in this material world is always going to face some anxiety or some disturbance in the mind. So such disturbance in the mind or anxiety can be completely, totally eradicated only by devotional service. Otherwise, it's not possible. So Krishna explains in the Bhagavad Gita how by doing devotional service, one can completely become totally free from all disturbances in the mind, including this difficult situation that we are all going through or facing at the present moment. We can become free from all disturbances simply by devotional service. Krishna gives an example in the second chapter. Just like the different rivers are entering an ocean, but the ocean is undisturbed. Similarly, desires may be there even in the heart or mind of a devotee, but the devotee is undisturbed by all these desires which come like rivers entering an ocean. And just like an ocean is undisturbed, you never see the ocean going beyond the limits. Otherwise, the cities on the shore of the ocean would all be flooded and would be completely destroyed. No, it never happens. So therefore, like that, the devotees who are engaged in devotional service, they are not overwhelmed by any desire that may arise. They simply are completely focused on devotional service to Krishna. So they have no disturbance from any desires that may arise in their heart. In that way, they are completely peaceful always, under all circumstances. Next question. If everybody and everything is equal before Krishna, rather Krishna resides in everyone and everything, then why does Bhagavad Gita mention the caste system? Good question. Yes, Krishna is equal. He doesn't have any partiality towards anybody. Bhagavad Gita talks about the caste system. Specifically, it talks about Varnashrama. Chaturvarnyam maya srishtam. These four social orders, occupational divisions, Krishna says he has created for the sake of people who are situated in different gunas, different modes of material nature. As you might be aware, there are three gunas: sattva guna, rajo guna, tamo guna. These are three qualities of material nature itself. Now, every person by birth, according to the past karma, they are born with a certain mix of these three qualities. So if somebody is predominantly having sattva guna, then they are called sattvic. If somebody is having rajo guna, they are called rajasic. If they are having tamo guna predominantly, then they are called tamasic. But according to these gunas being predominating, one guna predominating over the other two, they are inclined to work in a particular way. So Krishna says that according to your guna, you are inclined to work in a particular way. Therefore, you are recommended to work in a particular way suitable for your guna. Just like somebody is very, very intellectual, they are inclined to work using their intelligence. So they are suited for Brahminical type of duties, studying the scriptures, teaching the scriptures, guiding the society as regards the ultimate goal of life, or giving directions or instructions to people who may be requiring some direction or guidance, like that. So a Kshatriya is basically situated in Rajoguna, which is the inclination to do duty as a warrior or a protector of the weaker sections of society by maintaining law and order. So like that, everybody according to their guna, according to their nature, acquired nature, they are classified into different divisions to properly situate themselves as regards doing some occupational work. So Krishna is equal. He does not say one is lower than the other. That is the artificial thing that has happened in the last 300 or 400 years, that the caste system has become a vitiated, the Varnashrama system has become a vitiated caste system, that some people consider themselves as superior because they are Brahmanas by birth. They may not be having any Brahmanical qualities, may or may not have. But in any case, Krishna does not say one is superior to the other. He says by whatever qualities you have, you perform your natural duty or work, and by the result of that work, everyone should worship Krishna. Svakarmana tamabhyarcha siddhim vindati manavaha. If you want the ultimate perfection of life, whether you are Brahmana, according to your nature, you're working in a Brahmanical way, or like a Kshatriya or a Vaishya or a Shudra, you simply have to do your duty and offer the result to Krishna. That is the only way of perfection, and that is equally applicable to everyone. So in that way, Krishna is completely equal to everyone. Next question. On Ekadashi in Bangalore temple, we see all Vishnu Tattva deities garlanded with Tulsi garlands. We also see the deity of Sudarshan Chakra garlanded with Tulsi. Does Lord Sudarshana belong to the Vishnu Tattva category? Yesterday I explained something about the Supreme Lord in different forms, like Rama, Narasimha, Varaha. They all belong to the same category called Vishnu Tattva. That means one Supreme Lord, he is present in unlimited forms for the sake of his devotees. The way the devotees relate with him and render service to him. The same Supreme Lord is present in so many different forms. And he is a one and only Supreme Lord. The one Supreme Soul. The one Supreme Personality. But he is not limited by his particular form. He can be present in unlimited forms. So that is called Vishnu Tattva. Now, does Lord Sudarshana belong to Vishnu Tattva category? The answer is yes. Vishnu Tattva category. Sudarshan is also a personality in the Vishnu Tattva category. Next question. By mere reading of Bhagavad Gita, can we be able to attain liberation from birth and death? Now, this has to be qualified. The answer is yes. But reading means reading for the sake of understanding and following. So, academic study is not going to be enough. Just like somebody may say, I know all the 700 verses of the Bhagavad Gita. I have memorized them. Or even I am able to read them. Every day I read all the verses of the Bhagavad Gita. I recite the verses. But just reciting the verses without understanding or without following, more than understanding, it is the following. If one does not follow the instructions Krishna has given in the Bhagavad Gita, then how do you expect you will get liberation, which is possible by following the instructions? So what is expected is somebody reads the Bhagavad Gita, will understand the instructions of Krishna, will come to know about the instructions of Krishna, and actually follow those instructions to get the ultimate benefit of complete liberation from birth and death. Next question. Krishna is mentioned in our soul. What are the ways to worship him? Yeah, Krishna is present in our soul, everybody's heart, Krishna is present. So what are the ways to worship him, be connected with him throughout the day? That means with the Lord in the heart, how do you connect yourself? The Lord in the heart as Paramatma actually is appearing externally as the bona fide spiritual master. is appearing as Srila Prabhupada, the Guru, the Acharya. So by actually coming in contact with the Acharya and taking directions and instructions from him, in that way we will be able to understand and know about the Supreme Lord's presence in our heart. And when we advance in Krishna consciousness, we are able to come in touch with the Lord in our heart directly. Till then, we have to actually follow the instructions of the spiritual master. We have to worship the Lord in an external form, that is the form of the deity or a picture of the deity of the Lord. Or we also chant the Hare Krishna mantra, that is also the one of the external form in which the Lord has incarnated, in the form of the sound of his name, own name, holy name. So when we say Hare Krishna, the sound of Hare Krishna is actually Krishna himself. So that way we are able to directly contact Krishna. Next question. Attachment can be a cause for me to perform my duties. What is a sadhaka who has not yet developed attachment to Krishna or Guru? What will make him work? That means what will be the impetus or what will be the motivation to work? So just like attachment, some kind of material attachment is an inspiration or motivation for somebody to work materially. Same way, attachment for Krishna or Guru is the motivation for somebody to do service to Krishna or Guru. Now, before we develop attachment, we have an understanding that if I don't serve Guru and Krishna, then I am forced to serve the illusory energy, and the result is that it only gives me misery. So this understanding is required. This understanding is there in the scriptures. Our position is we are always servant. Servant means the only business is serving the master. So if we don't accept to serve our real master, Krishna, or before we actually come in proper contact with Krishna, we agree to serve his representative, the spiritual master, Guru, Acharya, then we are forced to serve the illusory energy in the form of Maya. Just like people, they may think that they are masters of this world or of their family or of their society or whatever. But actually, they are always servant of their senses. They are servant of their mind. They are servant of so many other things. They are servant of their dog. They are servant of their cat. They are servant of so many things. They are servant of anger. They are servant of lust. So servant one is, one always is, and one always will be. One always was. But you intelligently choose whom you want to serve. If you serve your senses, if you serve your mind, if you serve your anger, lust, greed, then that is only going to result in so much of misery and suffering for you. If you instead choose to serve Krishna or serve the spiritual master, then there is only freedom from all material miseries. There is spiritual progress, there is spiritual advancement, and eventually, by making proper progress, you'll be able to attain the ultimate liberation of eternal, blissful life full of knowledge. So that is the recommendation in the Bhagavad Gita. So with this understanding that if I don't serve Krishna, then I am forced to serve the illusory energy, one should intelligently choose to actually serve Krishna instead of serving the illusory energy. And that is possible in the beginning by simply following the instructions, by doing it as prescribed duty. So you do that prescribed duty with a intelligent understanding why you have to do it, even though you may not like to do it or you may not be attached to doing that. So as you keep doing, you become purified, you become advanced, and then you develop attachment for Krishna. Next question. What if someone is not experiencing peace and happiness after eating Krishna prasadam for many years? Yeah, it is told in the Bhagavad Gita that by taking Krishna prasadam, one is able to really experience real peace, and ultimately real peace is the foundation for real happiness. So one is able to experience real peace and real happiness if one makes a habit of regularly taking Krishna prasadam. Because this Krishna prasadam, what does it do? It purifies the heart of all material contamination. Our experience of not having peace of mind or not having real inner happiness is only because of the contaminated consciousness, or contaminated heart, materially contaminated heart. So those who are not taking Krishna prasadam, that means those who are simply eating without offering the foodstuff that they want to eat before eating, if they don't offer to Krishna, then they are simply eating something which will result in sin. That's what is explained in the Bhagavad Gita. So if you are sinful or you're eating sin, then you cannot expect peace, you cannot expect happiness. Now, what if somebody is not experiencing means they are either not understanding what this real, what is this meant by peace and happiness here, or they are not properly following Krishna's directions or the instructions of Bhagavad Gita in making a proper offering to Krishna and properly, we don't say eating Krishna prasadam, we say honoring Krishna prasadam. So by properly offering to Krishna and properly honoring Krishna prasadam, one is definitely able to purify one's heart, which naturally results in peace and happiness. And if somebody expects, in spite of properly offering and properly honoring Krishna prasadam, their expectation may be wrong. That's another reason why they feel, I am not getting peace. So this peace is not that you will be completely free from all material disturbances. As already told in the second chapter, a devotee, even though there are so many desires coming from within the heart, for material enjoyment, or so many different impulses from within the heart, so many different feelings or so many different thoughts, but a devotee never gives attention or gives importance to all such desires or feelings from within the heart. Devotee simply follows Krishna's instructions, Krishna's directions, and simply is engaged in devotional service to Krishna. That way the devotee is peaceful. Not that when I engage in devotional service, all material miseries will stop. They don't immediately stop. It requires some time for the material miseries to stop. So, till such time the material miseries completely stop, till that time one has to actually follow Krishna's instructions and carry on devotional service and become completely absorbed in devotional service. That way one can be actually peaceful. So it's time up. We'll take the remaining questions tomorrow. Tomorrow also we'll have a question answer session, because we have more questions here. So if anybody else also wants to ask questions, you can send those questions through live chat tomorrow, if you are not already sent. And if you already sent it, then if it is not answered yet, I'll answer tomorrow. Thank you. Hare Krishna.